Star Wars. Actually, I should do the turnaround. Nothing but Star Wars. So now Rogue One, A Star Wars Story is out. We have seen it. Some of us have seen it. Probably not all of you. If you want to see my spoiler-free review? Fantastic. I have that. The link is below. Go there, check it out. Have fun. No spoilers there for you. However, for this one, this is some spoiler talk. That's a spoiler warning for you. I'm giving you this opportunity to walk or check out the spoiler-free review. But spoilers are coming. You've been warned, so let's talk spoilers. So Rogue One, A Star Wars Story is funny because in my spoiler-free review, I said the first hour or so, it's a little slow, it's a little jarring leading up. Upon the second viewing, it didn't bother me as much, probably because I had already seen the movie and the characters and their path and where they end up, where they're going. So upon the second viewing, I was like, oh, it's those characters again. I know where they're going. It's nice to see them. Not to say it's always smooth. It's not always smooth, which is really funny. In my review, like every review out there, there's no such thing as a perfect film. Let's just say that right now. It's just not. So in every movie I see, there are negatives, and I address those negatives because people should be braced for those. And movies and people's love for movies got into a weird love-hate thing. It's like, well, a movie's either perfect or if it has flaws, it must suck now. How can you say a movie is that and it has flaws? Because that's a made-up word. I made it up. It could be whatever the fuck I want it to be. Does Rogue One have flaws? Yeah. Did I mean that the first time? Yeah. Is it better the second time? Yeah. Don't be so extreme. This or that. Love and hate. It's like everything is some shade of in between. So basically, the first act build-up, I mean, the movie starts out with no crawl. Could have benefited for a crawl in which the crawl would have just been that catalyst book that leads up to Rogue One. But they do a good enough job where Krennic comes down, meets Galen Erso's, Jyn Erso's dad's like, all right, there's been a problem. We need you back. He doesn't want to go back. So right there, you know, this Galen Erso guy is a big hand in the creation of the Death Star. They've hit a snag. The guy needs to go back with a gun to his head, and thus he does. It really is the Saw Gerrera thing I had a problem with, which I'm fine with Saw Gerrera now in the second showing. But that weird mind squid thing that probes minds, that thing's dumb. Let me just take it out altogether. You could have just had Saw Gerrera captures this pilot and just puts him in a cell to rot, and then they find him. They're like, oh hey, you need to come with us, and then that's that. It would have been the same outcome. If they cut the mind squid thing out entirely, would not change the film at all. Then again, you could do the same with Vader, and it wouldn't change the film at all. But you know, we'll get to the scene in a second. I suppose it just felt slow from my expectations. Also, it's hard to go into a Star Wars movie without expectations. You hear the Death Star, you're like, oh, we're gonna say the Death Star wrecks shit because it's on the trailer, it wrecks shit. But you shouldn't really think that because the biggest thing the Death Star ever did was wipe out Alderaan. That's certainly not gonna be in this movie. I do love when Johnny McCharming shoots the dude in the back. I mean, he shoots a couple of stormtroopers. Other stormtroopers are like, oh hey, there's a dick down there, and the dude with the busted arm's like, I can't crawl out of here with my arm, and the guy's like, he's right. And I can't let him go. So, all right, calm down. Blah, just shoots him in the back. I thought that was really cool because in a rebellion, you're gonna have to make calls like that. Rebellion ain't squeaky clean. I'm sorry. The original trilogy, it lied to you. I do like at a point, you said, I mean, Yavin 4 was great. All the audience clapped when we saw Yavin 4. I was like, oh, that's really cool to see Yavin 4. But then you see Jimmy Smits' Bail Organa. I really thought that was great because it really, these new movies and this new canon is doing what it can to bridge the gap between the two generations of Star Wars fans. There are people I know, they grew up on the prequels and they love the prequels because they grew up on them. And that's fantastic. I'm glad you have that. Then there are OG Star Wars fans who are like, I grew up with the original trilogy. The prequels are not good. And no matter what I wanna say about it, all right. Phantom Menace, I have fond memories of the Phantom Menace. I have nostalgia wrapped up in the Phantom Menace because the buildup of that was just, it was a lot of fun. The movie itself, not so great, but the buildup was fun. Revenge of the Sith, I can enjoy for what it is. Attack of the Clones, I can't quantify. It's just bad. But seeing Jimmy Smits really was a bridging of the worlds. It's like, oh, he was Organa in the prequels. Now he's Organa in, well, I guess this is technically a prequel. It's a movie that bridges to the new trilogy. I thought it's just a good move. And he says he's going back to Alderaan. You're like, don't do it, no. Let's talk about CGI Tarkin, because we gotta talk about CGI Tarkin. Peter Cushing, Grand Moff Tarkin is in this movie, but he is all CGI. When I first saw him, I was like, that is all CGI. I mean, I get why they had to do it. They did have to do it, because he's a big part of this. He was a big part of the Death Star. Why would he not be a big part of this movie? And actually, he's really cool. Upon the second time viewing it, I'm like, I'm glad I get to see Tarkin again, because Tarkin never really got a lot of shine. Tarkin was one of the two people Darth Vader took orders from in the original Star Wars trilogy. This dude is a big deal among the hierarchy of the Empire. I wanted to see him do more. Now I get to see him do more. Which really brings relevance to Krennic and the stress that he's under, man. He's got this project he needs to get off the ground. He needs to impress the Emperor. He has his boss breathing down his neck. He has his boss's boss breathing down his neck. He has his boss trying to take his shine away and take credit all himself. And just, I felt for the dude. I really did. Poor Krennic. Poor Imperial dick. But when I first saw CGI Tarkin, as much as I was like that CGI Tarkin, it's like the CGI of him got better as the movie progressed. I don't know if my eyes were just adjusting to the fact, but there were a couple lines, especially that line where he's like, the plans to the Death Star are down there, correct? I was like, that looks just like Peter Cushing as Tarkin. That was the best CGI of him in the movie. If for nothing else, I want them to devote every penny they have in perfecting and refining CGI Tarkin for the Blu-ray release. That is an adjustment, a tweak in CGI that I would be fine with. I've seen some reports of people saying it's disrespectful to have CGI Tarkin in this movie, and it detracts from Peter Cushing and it shits on him and his memory. I don't see it that way personally, because everything that Tarkin did in this movie was very much Tarkin. Like, if ghosts were real, I really feel like if you could ask Peter Cushing if it would be okay if they do this, I think he'd be like, oh yeah, it's perfectly fine, because that's very much Tarkin and the character, and it's in line with everything, and yeah, great, do it. I can't speak for him, I just feel like that's how it would go down. If Darth Vader was like fucking Grand Moff Tarkin in the ass while Grand Moff Tarkin wore a gag ball, I'd be like, yeah, that's out of character, that's disrespectful to the memory, and I don't think Peter Cushing would sign off on that. But that doesn't happen. Everything that Grand Moff Tarkin does in this movie is very much Grand Moff Tarkin. So I thought it was great. He even says at a point, you may fight when ready. Doesn't get more Tarkin than that. One of the things I love most about this movie is like when Jyn Erso sees the hologram of her father saying, hey Jyn, if you're out there, if you're watching this, if you're alive, I'm really sorry what you must think of me. But Galen Erso was pretty much like, they had me design this thing, and at a point, they would no longer, like, they don't need me to complete this thing. So I could either let the Empire create the super death weapon, in which case you guys could never beat it, or I could play the part, go along with it, be the main architect of the Empire's super death weapon, and put a failsafe in there in which you guys can destroy this thing. It's a very small failsafe, it's so small the Empire will never detect it, but if you can get the plans, you can see it. In which case, the biggest joke in the original trilogy, other than the Ewoks, is a little exhaust port that could just destroy this entire Death Star. We all thought, what the hell? This is stupid. How could they overlook that? Now it's purposely done. It's genius. It's fantastic. And now that joke is no longer a joke. It was done on purpose. I love that. It does put a problem with the J.J. Abrams thing, though. Starkiller Base really had the same thing. It's like this one thing, you take it out, destroys the entirety of this planet that is Starkiller Base. Ew, it throws back to the original, and that's why they did it, right? Well, does it? Because now we know it was sabotage for the Death Star. What was it for Starkiller Base? Did the architect of Starkiller Base go turncoat on them? Was he like, oh no, I have to do a failsafe to wipe out Starkiller Base? Not saying anything against Force Awakens. I love the Force Awakens. I'm just saying that does pose a problem for the whole concept. They just don't make them like they used to. I do love the Easter egg. Well, I love a lot of the subtle Easter eggs. There were some Easter eggs that were super on the nose. Like when Bail Organa's like, I'm sending for that Jedi that helped me in the Clone Wars. I'll go send for him. Oh, you'll need someone you trust. He's like, I trust her with my life. I do like what it does in the sense that in the original trilogy, it looks like they just conveniently came across the planet that had Obi-Wan Kenobi in it. Of all the planets in the galaxy, they just ended up there, and Leia was like, oh, what are we? Oh, thank God we're at Tatooine. That's where Obi-Wan is. So now you know she is purposely going to Tatooine, and the Empire got her ship, but not before she was like, all right, we're crawling across the finish line, just made to get the droids out of here. Oh, thank God. Oh, thank the Force. So it does stitch that up. Really, what this movie does, it really does stitch up the loose ends of the original Star Wars movie, A New Hope. However, there were some of those Easter eggs, like especially with Jimmy Smith's character, where he might as well have been like, ding! They know what I'm talking about, don't you, audience? However, the Easter eggs with the pilots, I imagine you noticed it. For those of you who didn't, here it is. Among the final battle, the last act of the movie, when Jyn Erso and the entirety of the Rogue One squadron are trying to get the plans to the Death Star, the X-Wings come in. Those X-Wing pilots, a lot of them were the pilots of the original Death Star raid. That was amazing. I loved that. You see, Gold Leader, you're like, wait, you're Gold Leader. The pilots that did the Death Star raid would be pilots that fought in this battle also. The Rebellions, they're not big and they ain't free. I love the fact also, like, Red 5, someone's on his tail, and this poor Red 5 is this little nerdy looking dude, like, oh, I'm not gonna make it, and he gets blown up. That's creating the position for a new pilot to come in and be Red 5, which was Luke Skywalker. K2SO shooting stormtroopers. He's like, I'm shutting the doors now. I'm locking it. Goodbye. Bam! And he gets shot and you see the light in his eyes go out. I was like, oh man, that was rough. That actually hit me. And then you know, you're like, these guys are not getting out of this alive. Figured it would be the case, but now you get to see it happen. Another standout death was Donnie Yen. He always says, I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me. I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me. And he has to flip that switch. There's a lot of fire. It's pretty much C-3PO has the Force now. We know that. I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me. I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me. Chanting, I'm one with the Force. The Force is with me. Lasers going by him because he's like, if it's all is as the Force wills it. If it's the will of the Force, I will flip that switch. If it's the will of the Force that I get shot and die, that's what's gonna happen. But right, dude. Hail Mary attempt! I gotta flip that thing. He makes it, and he dies. It was just a really touching, sad death. That shield around the world did make me laugh, though. I was like, you guys need to shut that shield down? I got the code for you. It's 12345, right? Which is an ironic circle that Spaceballs from Star Wars, Star Wars from Spaceballs. We're gonna talk Darth Vader. You want me to? Let's talk Darth Vader. Alright, let's talk Darth Vader. I love the fact that he's sparingly in this movie. He's not in it a lot. I didn't want him to be in it a lot. We got an entire trilogy of Darth Vader. I wanted some other people to get their shine. And in the world of progression, prorating it, it really does line up. This one's Orson Krennic and Grand Moff Tarkin with a little bit of Darth Vader. Krennic gets wiped out. The next one is Grand Moff Tarkin with Darth Vader. Grand Moff Tarkin gets wiped out, then it's Darth Vader. Then Darth Vader and the Emperor. You know, there's a progression of character where you're like, it does line up to make sense. But even Darth Vader's suit, when you look at it, alright, so the original Star Wars movie, his helmet was a little bigger, his eyepieces were red because it didn't have a big budget, so his eyepieces looked red. And his Sith sash in the original Star Wars movie, A New Hope, is on the outside of his shoulder piece. And then in Empire Strikes Back, his Sith sash is on the insides underneath his shoulder piece. This outfit, Darth Vader's outfit in here, everything about it is straight up A New Hope Darth Vader outfit. I love continuity like that, man. It's just fantastic. And I love when Orson Krennic goes to what is clearly Mustafar, and Vader's hanging out in what looks like Barad-dûr, and then Vader's in his tank, which I love a vulnerable moment like that with Darth Vader. It reminded me of Empire Strikes Back when his helmet gets put on and that one dude sees the back of his head and you're like, whoa, that's a vulnerable space that Vader's in right now. I love that. Same thing, but Vader does not have a suit. He is floating in a tank, but then that hooded figure's there. He's like, Lord Vader, Krennic is here for you. I'm like, oh, great. We get another Snoke theory because who's that guy? However, Vader comes out, talks to Krennic, and I love that because James Earl Jones' voice alone does not make Vader feel like Vader. In Revenge of the Sith, where is Padme? Is she okay? Is she all right? I'm like, you're still Hayden Christensen, which I get because he was Hayden Christensen a second ago. He's not gonna change so much in 10 minutes. But now when he walks out, this is straight up Vader. He's a very commanding presence. Orson Krennic's kind of stumbling on his words like, well, you know, I just want credit for the Death Star. Then he starts choking and Vader turns around and he's like, be careful not to choke on your aspirations. Get it? Anyhow, I'm gonna go back into my bath. I was kinda like, a pun, a funny. Vader's never really cracked a pun or a funny. So I prefer he didn't do that, but I love the fact that he just choked Krennic. But if we're talking about Vader, let's talk about the scene. So the Death Star plans have been beamed up. The Death Star has shot down onto this planet. It's just wiped out, which is a nice bit of irony. Not only does it wipe everyone out, but Orson Krennic dies from his own weapon. Love me the poetry. But the Death Star plans are up there. The rebels have it. They're going, they're running. Like, all right, we gotta get into the ship. We gotta get into the princess. The door doesn't open all the way. All the lights go out and you're here. And all of a sudden, bam, his lightsaber comes on. They all start shooting him, and he just deflect. Slice raises a dude up to the ceiling, holds him here, kills some other people, slices him on the ceiling in half. Everyone's like, this dude at the door, it's a crack. He's like, help us, help us. Vader is just charging in like a monster from a nightmare. This dude's just like, take it. Which I love that it went from help us to take it. Because at a point where he's like, help us, please save our lives. He's like, yeah, we're not living through that. This dude's gonna murder us all. So just take the plans. That's what's important. Dude takes the plans. Vader impales him through the door. Vader almost gets them. They get out of there. They leave. That is a standout Vader scene. We see why he is to be feared. We never really saw that in the original Star Wars. It wasn't too exciting, that fight. Then in Empire Strikes Back, he didn't want to murder Luke. It's a very personal thing where he just wants to disable him and then recruit him. Then Return of the Jedi is a very personal father-son battle moment among the two of them, so it's not really that murderously intense. This was straight up a murder. It was a slaughter. Not since the Younglings has Darth Vader had so much fun wasting humans. You could see it in his mask. The smile in the glint of his shaded eyes. Or maybe that was me. I loved it. I was smiling the entire time. And then they get the plans to Leia, and she turns around, she's CGI Leia, and they're like, what is this? And she's like, hope. And then they, boom, they go to warp, and then that's the end of the movie. And at that point, the best thing to complete the circle is you go home right there, you pop in a new hope, and that's where you are. Leia's ship comes over, the Star Destroyer's pelting it, and there it's 10 minutes later. It really seamlessly flows. It ties right into it. I've never seen that. Never in Star Wars history have we seen a film end right when the next one picks up. I thought it was great. It was really well done, and it reminded me of A New Hope, and it really does polish up A New Hope. The problems that I had with the plot lines in A New Hope were really stitched together. So that's it, guys. Death Star plans, Grand Moff Tarkin, Darth Vader, and the murder of some rebels down a really dark, scary hallway. So I know it being a spoiler talk, I didn't talk about everything in Rogue One to be expected, so I imagine there are things you wanted to talk about that I didn't talk about, so whatever those are, comment below, let me know, start the conversation down there, and as always, if you like what you've seen here and you want to see more, click right here to see more.